Mtsyri by Mikhail Lermontov, translated by Charles Johnson. Lermontov's title for the poem is Mtsyri. He explains in a note, Mtsyri in the Georgian language means a monk who does not serve, something in the nature of a novice. Mtsyri. I did but taste a little honey, and lo, I must die. 1 Samuel chapter 14, verse 4:43. 1. Once, not so many years ago, where soundingly together flow, Aragva and Kura the place, where like two sisters they embrace. There stood a monastery still. The traveler who comes down the hill sees pillars of a crumbling gate, towers, a church's vaulted state. But from it now there's no perfume of incense smoking in the gloom, and late at night no chanting rolls, no monks are praying for our souls. Just an old watchman, feeble, gray, attends the ruined church today. By men forgotten he has been, also by death, as he sweeps clean gravestones with legends which keep green tales of past fame, of how worn down beneath the burden of his crown a certain king conveyed his land in such a year to Russia's hand, and so heaven's benediction fell on Georgia. It has blossomed well. The hedge that friendly bayonets made since then has kept it unafraid, enclosed in its own garden shade.
2. Down from the mountains rode one day a Russian general on his way to Tiflis with a prisoner child. The boy was ill, the road had piled up too much for effort for him. Wild as mountain chamois, about 6, pliant and weak as kindling sticks. But in him his exhausted plight had called forth some ancestral might of spirit, for however faint he felt, no groan, no least complaint passed those young lips. He thrust aside all ordinary food in pride, and in silence he all but died. A monk took pity on the waif, tended his malady, and safe in sheltered walls he lived on there, brought back to health by loving care. At first detesting childish fun, he ran away from every one, and roaming silent all alone, looked to the east with sigh and groan, yearnings too deep to understand turning him towards his native land. But soon his prison sentence grew familiar, the strange language too. Then, christened by that holy man, he never knew the world. His plan, in the full prime of youth, was now to utter the monastic vow, when suddenly, one autumn night, he vanished, disappeared from sight. Hills darkly wooded rose all round. For 3 long days they searched the ground, in vain. Then on the steep they found him fainted. Once more brought him in, back to the cloister. He was thin and deathly pale and feeble too, as from some fever he'd been through, some hunger while he'd been away, or some ordeal. No word he'd say to questions. Visibly each day he faded and approached his end. Then came to him his reverend friend, with exhortation and with prayer. Proudly the sufferer heard him there, then raised himself with all the strength still left him, and thus spoke at length. 3. I thank you, sir, for coming here, for my confession in your ear. Words are the medicine that best will ease the burden of my chest. To others I have done no ill, and so my actions for you will be profitless to hear about, or can a soul be detailed out. I've lived my short life in duress, no, 2 such lives, For one of stress and terror willingly I would exchange them if I only could. I've known one thought, one and the same, a thought of passion and of flame. Worm-like it lived in me, it ate my soul away like fire in grate. My dreams from stifling cells estate, my prayers it called to that brave world where fears and battles are unfurled, where lost in cloud are cliff and scree, and where the, like eagles men are free. This passion in the dark midnight, nourished on tears with all my might, to heaven and earth I shout today, and for no pardon do I pray. 4. Often I've heard how you did save me, sir, from an untimely grave. For what? Alone and glum and pale, a leaf torn off by blast of gale. I've grown up within walls of gloom, in soul a child, a monk by doom. Mother and father, holy sounds, I could call no one in the bounds of sanctuary you hoped I'd lose the natural human wish to use the sweetest of all names, in vain. They were inborn, once and again. Others I saw on every hand, with home, friends, parents, native land. For me, not only, no one dear, not even dear ones' tombs were here. Then, without wasting time to weep, I took an oath I swore to keep, that at some time my burning breast, just for a moment, should be pressed against someone's perhaps unknown, yet from a land that was my own. But now, alas, they're dead, those dreams, in the full beauty of their gleams. And as I've lived, I'll find my grave, an alien soil, an orphaned slave. 5. I have no horror of the tomb. They say that suffering in that room sleeps in cold, everlasting calm. But to stop living, there's the harm. I'm young, young. Have you never known the dreams to which wild youth is prone? Have you not known, have you forgot, how hate was sharp, how love was hot, how the heart beat more keenly while from some tall battlement pile you saw the sun, the field spread round, and ear was nipping, and you found deep in the wall's recess sometimes a huddled nursling from far climes, a young dove that, driven in by fear of raging storms, has fluttered here. Perhaps the glorious world today has cooled for you. You're weak, you're gray, you've lost the habit of desire, but you no longer need the fire. You've got things to forget for you. You've lived. I wish I could live too. 6. You ask what I contrived to see during the days while I was free. Rich plains and hills that trees had crowned, woods running riot all around, in whispering clusters fresh as spring, like brothers dancing in a ring. And frowning cliffs I saw whose heart, cleft by the torrent, beat apart. I guessed their thoughts, diviner's art, was given to me from on high, their stone embracing in the sky, long since cut off each day, each night, they long, they thirst to reunite. But years and ages pass in vain, and never they shall join again, and I saw mountain crests that seem fantastical as any dream, where, at the earliest hour of dawn, as if from altar smoke was drawn, up from the peaks into the blue, and little clouds came swarming through, leaving their secret sleeping place, turning to east their hurrying face, in a white caravan like bands of birds flown in from distant lands. Far off I saw, through vapory strands, where glittering diamond of the snows, gray bastion Caucasus arose. And then, for some strange reason, I felt light of heart in days gone by. A secret voice so prompted me, I'd live here, I began to see, ever more clearly, now at last, places and things from time long past. Seven. And I remembered Father's hall, and our ravine, our village, all, in cool shadow dispersed around. I heard the evening thunder sound, as homing horses galloped through, the distant bark of dogs I knew. On moonlight evenings, memory traced the row of elders, swarthy faced, who sat with serious looks before my father's porch. No, I saw more. I saw the chiseled scabbards gleam on their long daggers like a dream. A row of pictures, indistinct, came and before my vision winked. My father, as in life, all pranked in armor stood there, chainmail clinked, as I remembered light ablaze from rifle barrels, and that gaze, that proud, indomitable stare, and my young sisters, too, were there. Their sweet eyes shone, their voices rang. Once more I listened as they sang, over my crib. A torrent sprang down our ravine, it roared, it rolled, but it was shallow on its gold. Sands I would play at noon, my sight pursued the swallows in their flight, as when a storm of rain was due, they grazed the water while they flew. I saw again our peaceful hall, at evening round the hearth, we all listened to tales that would recall how men lived in days long since gone, days when the world still brighter shone. 8. What did I do, you seek to know, while I had freedom? I lived so, my life was sadder far than this, dotage of yours had it to miss, those 3 days of perfected bliss. It's long since I began to yearn, to see far fields and to discern, if earth was beautiful to learn, whether for freedom or for goal, we come to this terrestrial vale. So, in that dreadful hour of night, when thunder struck you down with fright, when by the altar pressing around, you lay all prostrate on the ground, I fled. I'd have been glad to race, to enfold in brotherly embrace that storm. My gaze pursued each cloud, my hands caught lightning bolts. Speak loud, tell me, inside this walled-in space, what would you give me to replace the friendship keen, though brief and frail, that stormy hearts feel for the gale? Nine. And so I ran, long hours and far, I knew not where, no single star lighted me on my stumbling way. Joyful it was for me to stray, to let my tortured chest assay the midnight freshness of the wood. No more than that I ran a good while long, and then, worn out at last, lay on a tussock thickly grassed, and listen no sounds of chase. The storm had died, a feeble trace of light, a radiance seemed to lie between the earth and the dark sky, and patterned on it stood out plain the peaks of a far mountain chain. Silent, unmoving, and unseen, I lay at times from the ravine, like a small child, a jackal wailed, and smoothly, glitteringly scaled between the stones a serpent slipped, and yet my soul was never gripped by fear. Wild as a beast, I slid, snake-like away from man and hid. 10. Storm-swollen on the lower ground, a torrent roared, and its dull sound resembled closely, so I found, 100 angry voices. I could understand this wordless cry, this unformed murmur, endless shock of wrangling with hard-fronted rock. Now all at once the tumult felt silent. Now it began to swell and break the stillness all about. Soon on that misty height rang out the song of birds, and then to east turned golden, suddenly released. A breath shook leaves on every bough. The sleepy flowers breathe perfume now, and like them I saluted day, looked out. And it's no shame to say, as I peered around, I quaked with fear. I had been lying on the sheer brink of a frightful cliff. From here, an angry torrent far below went whirling onward, and to show the way down, steps cut in the face. Only a fiend expelled from grace, thrown down from heaven, could ever dare to seek hell's caverns down that stair. 11. And all around God's garden bloomed, flowers that in bright raiment loomed, still kept a trace of tears divine, and curling tendrils of the vine would brilliantly amid the sheen cast by the leaves pellucid green, while on them heavy clusters slung were like rich earrings as they hung in splendor. Sometimes to them flew a flock of birds in timorous crew. Once more I lay back on the ground, once more I listened to that sound, to those strange voices in the scrub whispering away to every shrub, as if they had by magic spell secrets of earth and sky to tell. All nature's voices there were blurred together, nowhere to be heard one single human tongue to raise the morning's hour's majestic praise. All that I felt then, all my mind was thinking, left no trace behind. If only I could tell it then, just for a flash I'd live again. Heaven's vault, it was so clear and chaste that morning's sharp eyes could have traced the flight of angels through and through, such even deep translucent blue, my eyes and my soul drowned. But soon, under the blaze of sultry noon, my reveries were all dispersed, and I began to pine with thirst. 12. Then to the torrent, from that height, from crag to crag, as best I might, clutching the pliant bushes, I set off downhill. A rock would fly from underfoot and roll and bound, smoking the dust behind it wound. It rumbled down with jump and thud, and then was swallowed in the flood. Dangling I hung above the scree, but death had no alarms for me, for hands are strong when youth is free. As I groped down the steep descent, the mountain's water's freshness went aloft to meet me, and I fell thirstily on the torrent swell. Then all at once, voice and light, footfalls, and in instinctive fright, I ducked behind the scrub, and out timidly I peered round about. I listened with a kind of thirst, and ever nearer, burst by burst, the Georgian maiden's singing rang. With such an artlessness she sang, so sweet and clear and free her tone, you'd think she'd learned to sing alone the names of loved ones of her own. Nothing more simple than that strain, but in my thought it lodged again. At nightfall I can hear it ring, as if unseen her soul should sing. 13. Holding her pitcher on her head, the maiden took the path that led down to the mountain torrent's bed. Sometimes on rock her foothold slipped, she laughed as awkwardly she tripped.
Her dress was humble down the track. She walked light-footed and brushed back her winding chadra. Sultry days had covered in a golden haze her face, her breast, and summer's glow breathed from her mouth and cheeks, but so deep was the darkness of her eyes, so full of secrets to surmise, love secrets, that my head went round. All I remember is the sound the jug made as it slowly drowned, a murmuring through the torrent flood. When I came to, and when the blood had flowed back from my heart, she'd gone some distance off as she walked on. Slow, yet light-footed, straight and trim, beneath her load she was as slim as any poplar tree that stands and queens it over neighboring lands. Not far away, in close embrace, two cabins grown from the rock face loomed through the chilly evening mist. Above one's roof, in a blue twist, smoke rose, as now I see again how the door gently opened, then it shut once more. For you, I know, it's past conceiving why I'm so brimful of yearning and so sad. It's past conceiving, and I'm glad. The memory of those moments I would wish in me, with me to die.
14. By the night's travail quite worn out, I lay down in the shades without effort. My eyes were sealed about by blissful sleep. I saw once more that Georgian girl, and as before, a strange, sweet yearning came to break my heart and make it pine and ache. I fought to breathe, but soon I woke up, and by now the moon was high and shining. After it, a single cloudlet seemed to flit, with arms wide open for the embrace, and the dark world was still in space. Far distant ranges tipped with snow sparkled away and seemed to throw a silhouette of silvery glow. Splashing its banks, I heard the stream, and in the cabin a faint gleam would flicker up and once more die. Just so across the midnight sky, a bright star shines, then dies up there. I longed to, but I didn't dare go over to the hut. I planned one thing to reach my native land, one thing alone, so hunger's pain I quelled as best I could. Again I started on the straightest way, timid, without a word to say, but all at once began to stray. As soon as in the forest's night I'd lost the mountains from my sight. XV. In my despair to no avail, I clutched at moments on my trail. Some thorny bush with ivy crowned, eternal forest all around, grew denser, grimmer every pace, with million coal-black eyes. The face of darkest night looked through the scrub, peered through the twigs of every shrub. My head was turning. For a time I tried the trees, began to climb, but always on the horizon's edge the same woods rose in spire and wedge. Then I threw myself down and lay, sobbing in a despairing way, biting the earth's damp breast. A spell of weeping came, and my tears fell to the ground in scalding streams of dew. But help from men, I swear to you, I'd have no at no price. Through and through, like a steep beast to all their crew, I felt a stranger, and if my weak tongue had by the feeblest cry betrayed me, reverend father, why, I'd torn it out as I may die. 16. You will recall, no teardrop came from me in childhood. All the same, I now was weeping without shame. For who could see me except the dark forest, the moon high on its arc, lit by its rays all floored with sand and moss? I saw before me stand impenetrably walled a glade. Suddenly there a flickering shade, two sparks of fire that darted round from the dark forest in one bound. A creature sprang, rolled on its back, lay playing on the sandy track. It was the waste's eternal guest, the huge snow leopard he caressed, a moistened bone he gnawed at it, squealed for sheer enjoyment. Then he wheeled on the full moon, his bloodshot eyes, thumping his tail in friendliest wise. His coat with silver gleams was shot. I waited for the fight. I'd got in hand a cudge, and on fire my heart with sudden wild desire for war and blood. Yes, fate, I'll say, has led me on a different way. But if I'd lived at home, I swear I'd never have been counted there as one of those who feared to dare. 17. I waited. Now through shades of dark, he smelt an enemy, and hark, a sad howl like a groan drawn out came forth in rage. He set about to paw and furrow up the sand. He reared right up as people stand. He crouched in his first furious leap. He threatened me with eternal sleep, but I forestalled him, and my stroke was sure and swift. My cudgel broke open his wide brow like an axe. He toppled over in his tracks, groaned like a man, but now once more, though blood was streaming from his score, in a broad, thickly pulsing vein, the mortal fight boiled up again. 18. He rushed my chest in one swift bound, but with my weapon I had found his throat. Twice I had turned it round. He whined, and with his final strength began to jerk and twitch at length. Like a snake couple tight and laced, more closely than two friends embraced, we fell together in dark night, continued on the ground our fight. And at that moment I was wild and fiercer than the desert's child. The snow leopard like him I blazed, I howled as if I had been raised by leopards and by wolves beneath the wood's cool overhanging sheath. It seemed as if I'd lost the power of human language in that hour. My chest brought out a wild sound. Why? It seemed from childhood never I had learned to make a different cry. But weakness now crept on my foe. He tossed, he turned, he breathed more slow. He crushed me one last time in ire. His staring pupils threatened fire, then gently closed up in the deep onset of everlasting sleep. But meeting death, he knew to keep facing it and his conquering foe the way a fighting man should go. 19. You see these deep scars on my chest, scooped where the leopard talons pressed. They hadn't grown together still, they gape, but earth's damp cover will bring them the freshness of the field. By death forever they'll be healed. I forgot all about them then, called my reserves of strength again, in deepest forest plunge and straight. But all in vain my fight with fate. It laughed at me and my estate. 20. I left the woodland. Now the day was waking up before its ray. The dance of traveling stars went out. Then the dark forest all about began to talk from an aul, for off smoke started up, a full boom from the gorge, a voiceless hum blew on the wind, I heard it come. I sat and listened, but it died. Just as the breeze did far and wide, I turned my gaze that countryside. Surely I knew it, and a strong terror came over me forlorn. I couldn't credit that once more I'd headed back to prison, or that all these days I spent in vain nursing my secret hope, the pain, the yearning patience every hour, and all for what? That in the flower of years and hardly having seen God's world, that having scarcely been allowed in murmuring woods to know the bliss of freedom, I must go and carry with me to the tomb the longing for my home, the gloom of cheating hope and of self-blame, of your compassion and its shame. Still sunk in doubt, I lingered there. I thought it was some nightmare. Suddenly, in the silence fell once more the distant tolling bell, and all was lucid in no time. At once I'd recognize its chime. How often from my childish eyes it had chased out the bright disguise of dreamland forms of kith and kin, the steep's wild liberty, the spin of light-foot horses and the shocks and splendid fights among the rocks. And I, the winner, so I heard, tearless and strengthless, in a word, it seemed my heart was where the chime came from, as if someone each time struck it with iron. Then I knew, though vaguely nothing I could do, would to my homeland bring me through. 21. Yes, I've deserved my destined course. On the strange steep, a mighty horse, with its unskillful rider thrown from far off, will find out alone the straightest, shortest homeward way. I cannot equal him each day. In vain my heart desires and yearns, feeble the flame with which it burns. Plaything of dreams, malaise of mind. On me my prison left behind its brand. Just so there grows in goal on the wet flags alone and pale a blossom, and long time puts out no youthful leaves, but waits about, languishing for life-giving rays. It waits, and there pass many days till some kind hand touched by the grief of the poor bloom to bring relief moves it to a rose garden where from every side there breathes an air of life and sweetness. But once there, no sooner comes the sunrise hour than with its incandescent power it scorches the goal-nurtured flower.
22. Just like that blossom I was burned by day's remorseless fire, I turned to no avail my weary head. I hid it in the grass instead. My brow by withered leaf was wreathed in thorny crown, and the earth breathed into my face its breath of flame. High above me circling came motes in the sun, the vapor steam from the white rocks. God's whole world seemed numbed in a very heavy slumber there, the deep, dull slumber of despair. If only the corncrake from the hill had called, if only the quick trill of dragonfly wings, or a rill childishly chattering. Just a snake was rustling through the dried-up brake. Across its yellow back, light played as if upon a golden blade, engraved all down with letters, and scattering a small wake of sand, it crawled meticulously. Then it played, it basked, it writhed again, and triple coil then gave a start, just as if scalded in the dark. It dived inside the bush's heart, and deep in scrub it disappeared.
23. But now the sky was calm and cleared of cloudscape. Far through mists that steamed rose two dark mountains, and there gleamed underneath one of them a wall, our cloister's battlement hall. Aragva and Kura below were laughing with their silvery flow at feet of islands cool and fresh, at whispering bushes and their mesh of roots and pulsing on their way in gentle harmony. But they were too off. I tried to rise. Everything whirled before my eyes. I tried to shout. My dried-up tongue, voiceless and motionless, it hung. I seemed to die, herald of death. A madness crushed me, squeezed my breath, and then it seemed to me that I, on the moist bed, had come to lie. Of a deep river, there I found mysterious darkness all around. And quenched my eternal thirst in the ice cold stream, and bubbling burst into my chest, came flowing deep. My only fear, to fall asleep. So sweet, so blissful was my plight. And there above me in the height, wave thronged on wave, and through the bright crystal of the water sun beamed. With a moon's graciousness it gleamed. From time to time across its ray, fish in bright flocks began to play. And one more friendly than her mates caressed me, backed with scaly plates of gold. I still can see her coat as round my head she came to float, and deeply gazing, her green eyes were sweetly sad and profound. Amazement seized me at the sound of her small voice's silvery strain. It sang to me, then ceased again. That voice, it seemed to say, "My child, do thou stay here with me. Our life down in this watery wild is cool and rich and free. My sisters and I will enroll, and with our circling dance we shall divert thy weary soul and cheer thy fainting glance. Now sleep away soft is thy bed, thy sheet shot through with gleams. The years, the ages, or they thy head will pass in wondrous dreams. Beloved, let me tell thee true, I love thee as down here the current flowing freely through, and my own life are dear." Long, long I listened, and I found the stream had set its quiet sound, the tale its lilting whisper told to music from that fish of gold. I swooned. The light that God had lit quenched in my eyes the raving fit, passed from my fainting body then. 24. So I was found, but here again I finished, for you know what more there is to tell, believe me, or believe me not, I do not care. Just one thing grieves me, this I swear. My body, lifeless, cold, and dumb, will never to my homeland come, to moulder there my grievous thrall. In the deaf circle of this wall will never be rehearsed or claim a sad repute for my dim name. 25. Father, your hand please in farewell, mine is in fire, as you can tell. Since childhood well concealed, suppressed, this flame has lived inside my breast. But now there's nothing left that burns, it's blazed its way out and returns. Returns once more to him who gives just measure to each man who lives of pain and peace. But what do I care? Yes, in realms behind the sky my soul will find its refuge due. Alas, I'd rather for a few moments among those steep and strange rocks where my childhood used to range, heaven and eternity I'd change. 26. But when I'm dying for that date, believe me, there's not long to wait. Give orders I be carried out into our garden just about, where bloom two white acacias, where the turf so thick and the cool air so perfumed, and the leaves that play so limpid gold in the sun's ray. There bid them set me of bright day, and the sky's radiant blue I will, for there for the last time drink my fill. Thence Caucasus is clear to see, perhaps down from his summit he will send me on the wind's cold breath his farewell. And before my death, perhaps near by, once more I'll hear my native tongue and someone dear. I'll dream some brother or some friend. How gently over me he'll bend, how tenderly he'll wipe my brow clean of death's icy sweat, and how he'll sing to me in undertone of that dear country once my own. And so I'll sleep.